I'm going to be real because I live this life and I'm not rich and I'm brown and I look like probably most of you. First of all, it doesn't get better. But what does happen is that you get stronger.
Hi, my name is Gabby Rivera. I'm a writer living in Oakland, California, but from the Bronx, New York, and my pronouns are she, her.
Gabby, it's so great to finally meet you. So we're gonna talk obviously about your journey and it gets better, but I wanna talk first about your childhood. So tell me a little bit about what your childhood was like.
My childhood, oh wow. I had like two little cute Puerto Rican parents. My mother was a public school teacher, kindergarten teacher for like 30 years in New York City. My father was a salesman for Cafe Bustelo Coffee. And so I grew up very Puerto Rican, but also like very American, like in the Bronx, right? Like two family house. My parents were super religious. So we went to church every Sunday.
You talked about kind of having a religious upbringing, which isn't always the most positive experience when you are a member of the LGBTQ plus community. So tell me a little bit about when you first came to the realization that you were a part of the LGBTQ plus community.
Yeah, for the longest time, I didn't know what was wrong with me. I was like, does everyone feel this way watching Gia with Angelina Jolie? I don't know. Like, I actually like loved church as a little kid. I feel like a lot of little kids love church. You get to go and play and sing songs and like Jesus loves you, you know? But as you get older, right, and things start to shift, that changes. There are a lot of folks who gatekeep who gets to be close to God, who gets to have access to heaven and joy and forgiveness, you know? So as I was like leaning towards more of a tomboy aesthetic, I was definitely ostracized in church because of that, because little girls need to look like little girls and little boys need to look like little boys and wear suits, you know. You know, my mom at times was like, you know, I can handle you getting HIV or getting pregnant, but don't you dare tell me you're a lesbian. And I just hated that, right? Like, I hated it in church. It made me sad because like how was being a lesbian like the one thing that would make my mom never love me again, you know?
I'm a preacher's kid, and so I definitely grew up with a religious upbringing too. So hearing how your mom reacted sounds familiar, but I want to take a moment to read an excerpt from your original It Gets Better message. Coming out to my parents was insane. I thought God was going to strike me dead as the words came out of my mouth. My dad was cool, but my mom flipped like it was the end of her world. The world that had me as a straight woman that would give her grandkids. I also thought God would just turn his back on me. I asked him through prayer every night to take my life, seeing as though I was a deviant homosexual. God never took my life, and so I viewed that as a sign to carry on.
God made all of us, so God made me. Therefore, in my mind, God is cool with like being gay. And if Jesus was alive, he would chill with us because everybody else hates us.
First of all, I got a little emotional reading that because I remember praying for God to take this away, praying for my life to be over because if this was something that I couldn't get rid of, I didn't know what to do. But hearing those words, how does it feel hearing that back now in 2020?
It hurts, but it also feels really good to know that even in my early 20s, I wasn't afraid to like be honest and talk about it, and talk about that pain. And like, you know, I spent like at 15, 16, almost every night crying and praying and being like, well, God, if you made me like this, you can undo this. I didn't ask for this. All I wanna do is like be close to you, you know, and be a good person. And you know what's interesting? When I made that video, I was in a really tough point in my life. I was so sad the night I made that video. And it was like all of my emotions came out because I was just so frustrated. Like I needed a break and I needed people to see that like it doesn't just like magically change. That you really have to fight and it really, you know, it takes us out. A lot of us don't make it through. You know what I mean? And so it felt heavy and beautiful to have that moment.
Your mom is in that essay, says she's practically a gay rights advocate now. But how did you get through that difficult moment with your mom in the process of you coming out?
You know, if you really evangelical, you think your soul's going to heaven and your gay kid's soul is going to hell. And so, like, that's a whole lot of spiritual reckoning that my mother, folks' parents have to do. And as the kid trying to figure out your identity, you've done enough work. You will do enough work. Your parents need to figure that out, and that's okay. Being a teacher, she got her first gay couple, two black dads had a son in her class. And that really opened that world up to my mom in a different way, in a way that was still very direct, but not based on her kid. And that moment, that journey for her was like instrumental. She loved them. She loved their kids. She started coming home being like, you know, I don't understand why they don't let gay people have babies, because Joshua's fathers, or whatever the kid's name was, right? Like, she would just started to become her own advocate. And so to me, that was proof that, like, I'm good taking my time, taking my space, having my boundaries. My mom's either gonna figure it out or she's not. And like, look at her, she's doing it. You know, she's doing her own work.
Well, in that message, you talked about becoming stronger. Is there a specific time that you can recall where you felt like you were stronger because of the things that you've gone through?
You know, last year, 2019, I was finally on like my first ever book tour with Juliet Takes a Breath. It was one night I was in Chicago and I hadn't called anybody. I hadn't mentioned that I would be in town. I completely like messed up my promo for that event. And yet when I got there, it was like over 100 plus people at this reading. And Chicago was also the place where my best friend Christina, who passed away in my late 20s, where she thrived as a lesbian Puerto Rican woman. So like, I felt her spirit there. And when I saw like this 100 plus group of like trans people, dykes, non-binary folks, black and brown people, just like my whole, like my vision of what a beautiful world looks like sitting out there in front of me, I just felt so moved in my heart. I felt so healed. I felt so glad that I was still alive, like that I had never taken myself out, that I had never let the sadness or the aches or the like the tremendous feelings of grief and loss be the things that take me out. And I think that it healed so much of the pain that I have carried from when I was a little kid to through the teenage years. Whatever was unhealed in me, like in that moment, I felt like baptized, you know? I felt baptized in the glory of queerness and community, you know?
Well, I know that your message impacted so many people, but we're in 2020 now, and there's still people who are struggling, who are feeling alone and isolated. So if you were able to give a message of hope or support to a young LGBTQ plus person who felt alone and isolated right now, what would you say?
Man, to all the like queer kids of color out there, if you are feeling alone and lost, know that we are all right here. We are waiting for you. We love you. You are enough. You are magnificent. The ancestors manifested you, or femfested you, whichever you prefer. And there is fullness. The universe is yours, completely and truly. Make no compromises. You are enough. Hold on to yourself.
I love that so much. Gabby, this was such a pleasure. Thank you for everything that you have done and that you are doing for the community. And this really was such a great chat with you.
Thank you so much. What a pleasure. It gets better. 2020.